Good morning. I'm the Reverend Wendy Keene, and I am the Sunday Supply Minister. As I've been welcomed by this community, so I extend that welcome to all of you. Whether this is your home congregation, or you are visiting us, or found us online by accident, know that the Spirit of Christ is with us whenever and wherever we worship. This morning's reader is Janet McLean. Byron Herman is providing the music for the service. Christine Eit and Sam Schwartz assembled the PowerPoint, and Jack Godfrey is doing Zoom for us. Thank you to all of you for your ministry.
Stairs Memorial United Church acknowledges we are in Mi'kma'ki,
the unceded territory and ancestral homeland of the Mi'kmaq Nation. Our relationship is based on a series of peace and friendship treaties between the Mi'kmaq Nation and the Crown, dating back to 1725. In Nova Scotia, we recognize that we are all treaty people.
Our candle is lit this morning to remind us of Jesus' promise that wherever two or more gathered in his name, he would be there with them. Christ is with us. Thanks be to God.
Churches wherever God's people are praising, singing God's goodness for joy on this day. The churches wherever disciples of Jesus remember his story and walk in his way. The churches wherever God's people are helping, caring for neighbors in sickness and need. The churches wherever God's people are sharing the words of the Bible in gift and in deed.
Oh, come, let us sing to God. Let us shout out with joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving. Let us joyously shout to God with songs of praise.
Come, children, join to sing Hallelujah. Praise to our servant King. Gracious choice, now in this place rejoice. Alleluia. Come, lift your hearts on high. Alleluia. Let praises fill the sky. Oh,
Let us pray. Holy God, you have called us together to worship just as we are. We cannot pretend to be what we are not, for you have made us and know us through and through. In our weakness, we come with prayers for strength. In our strength, we come with prayers of thanksgiving. Open our hearts that we might pray honestly and await your answers with renewed faith. May our praise and our worship be unrestrained. Amen.
Jesus shall reign where thou sigh, thus the successor journeys round. His kingdom spreads from shore to shore, him who shall wax and reign no more. People and realms of dwell on his love, receive a song, and infant voices shall proclaim their early blessings on his name. Blessings abound where he reigns, and prisoners leap to lose their chains. The weary find eternal rest, and all who suffer what are blessed. Let every creature rise and bring peculiar honor to our King. Angels descend with songs again, and earth repeat the loud Amen.
The scripture reading this morning is Psalm 34, 15 to 22, and John 6, 56 to 69. Psalm 34. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to blot out their name from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. The righteous person may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. Evil will slay the wicked. The foes of the righteous will be condemned. The Lord will rescue his servants. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. John 6. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. He said this while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. On hearing it, many of his disciples said, "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept this?" Aware that his disciples were grumbling about this, Jesus said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you see the Son of Man ascend to where he was before? The Spirit gives life, the flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of the Spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them would not believe and which would betray him. He went on to say, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless the Father has enabled them." From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. "You do not want to leave too, do you?" Jesus asked the 12. Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God."
How would you answer the question, "Who are you?" What if you were at the wrong address? What if you were going through customs overseas? You were on a blind date? Or you were at a police checkpoint? You're asked, "Who are you?" Your answer and your tone of voice would probably vary, depending on who was asking the question and what was happening at the time. And I'm guessing none of us would say, "I am one with you." For anyone who may have done a Bible study on the Gospel of John, you likely noticed that Jesus makes a number of "I am" statements. He makes 7 of them, in fact. "I am the bread of life," in John 35. "I am the light of the world," in 8:12. "I am the door," or some translations have it, "I am the gate." "I am the good shepherd." "I am the resurrection and the life." "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And in chapter 15, verse 15, "I am the vine." Each of these "I am" statements is Jesus' response to help those who asked to understand who he is in relationship to God. And each of these statements describes one facet or quality of Jesus and how he connects us to God. Jesus was incredibly wise about people. Because he was so intensely interested in us, we wanted to remember those things that he told us. And Jesus was deeply aware of what makes us tick, what gives us joy, what causes us to fear or to grieve. Above all, Jesus was able to meet people and understand what it was they needed for their own health and well-being, psychologically, physically, and spiritually. These "I am" statements were meant to help people see the many ways God was always and everywhere reaching out to us and fulfilling promises to us. And all of this was in order to help all of creation flourish, to be abundant, and it was intended to help nourish all living things. In a world where humans have taken so much control away from nature, it can be hard for us to find room for God's activity, especially in places where we have grocery stores and corner stores and big box stores overflowing with goods and the necessities of life. Who remembers the near impossibility of getting toilet paper in last year at the start of the pandemic? It was a real problem for many people. But on another level, hoarding toilet paper was incredibly selfish and unthinking, especially when so many in the world don't have access to safe sanitation or clean water. I am the light of the world. Who worries about the darkness when a flick of the switch brightens the room, or the backyard, or the driveway? The light of the world doesn't mean quite the same in a time and a place when many of us need blackout curtains to block out the streetlights from our bedrooms, or to help shift workers sleep during the day. Same with the vine. If you have easy access to clean drinking water, your dependence on vineyards to provide you with safe drinkable liquids is much less than it was for our ancestors in faith. Or the shepherd. If you know you will sleep indoors behind a locked door every night, you don't need to know that someone is watching over you while you sleep. I don't want to belabor the point, but I hope you see that instead of being the most difficult of the four Gospels, the Gospel of John is in many ways the most reassuring, and its picture of Jesus is one of the best able to respond to the needs of the world. There's an old saying, act as if everything depends on you, and pray as if everything depends on God. I dare say that in Jesus' day, like today, many people paid a lot of attention to the first part, act as if everything depends on you, and only occasionally remembered the second, pray as if everything depended on God. Yet it is the praying that is of the utmost importance. That old saying doesn't mean that we aren't doing our part to cooperate with God, but it reminds us that praying isn't just about us. When I can't bear the news about what is happening somewhere in the world, something I am powerless to change, I pray. When I can't muster up the nerve to do something I know I ought to, I pray. When I have given what I can or done what I can and so much more is needed, I pray. Now, you may be wondering why I'm talking about Jesus' I am statements, because he doesn't make one in our reading from the gospel this morning. But what Jesus is doing is he's developing the meaning of those I am statements made throughout the gospels up until this point. In verse 35, when he said, I am the bread of life, many who were in the audience to hear that were outraged. Now, they weren't outraged because he claimed to be bread. They were outraged because he used the verb I am. And that's because in Hebrew, I am translates as Yahweh, which is the name that God calls himself in Exodus 3, verse 14. Back, way back, when the Israelites were wandering through the desert for 40 years. When Jesus made his first I am statements, he used that phrase deliberately and did so knowing that for many Jews, including their religious leaders, it was considered a name or phrase too holy to utter out loud. Yet it's used all the time in the older Hebrew Testament. If you look it up sometime, you will notice the word Lord, L-O-R-D, spelled in capital letters. That is the accepted translation of the word the ancient writers used to represent God's personal name. So back to my question at the beginning of my reflection. How do you answer the phrase or the question when someone asks, who are you? Well, it depends on the situation, and it depends on who's asking. And perhaps here we can understand the anger of the leadership in Jesus' day when he uses the words, I am, and the careful protection the ancient Hebrew leadership had placed around God's personal name. If you aren't afraid to use God's personal name, that's your business. But if you are careful or you are made uncomfortable about how you answer questions about your identity, think about why that is. What is it about the essence of who you are that is precious to you? And how is that connected to your name? Why is it when someone asks us who we are, we often have different answers depending on where and when we're being asked? And how much of this is connected to the fact that it is hard work to give a truthful description of who we really are that others will accept? Tell you a story. I was with the Royal Canadian Navy in the southern United States the day before the election of Donald Trump to the presidency. The atmosphere was very tense and very uncomfortable. The night before the vote, a number of sailors from the ship were waiting at the pickup place where the ship's shuttle was going to pick them up, you know, meet them after having been down, pick them up and take them back safely to the ship. And while they were waiting at that point, a large number of people returning from a Trump rally surrounded them and demanded to know who they were voting for. Using the phrases that we had been instructed to say before we left the ship, in order to maintain our political neutrality and our physical safety, the sailors said, "We are Canadians. We are members of the Royal Canadian Navy, and we are not allowed to vote in your election. We do not have an opinion." The crowd did not like that answer. So they pressed the sailors again and again and again, asking them who they were voting for. And again, the crew members repeated that rather long phrase about political neutrality. Anyways, they reached a point where they recognized they were in danger of getting beaten up. And so one of the Canadians said, "Hey, nice signs. Can we have one?" Problem solved. I woke up the next morning on the ship. It was covered from stem to stern inside and in Trump banners and posters and flags and bric-a-brac like there was no tomorrow. Who are you? Well, the answer depends on who wants to know and what it will cost you. The people of Israel were desperate to know who Jesus was because it was important to know, could you trust what he was saying? Who are you? What will it cost you to be fully honest? Well, we know the price that Jesus paid for never backing down on his claim that he was the Son of God and the Messiah. That is good news. Sometimes it can be uncomfortable news, but one in the same. It is the news that so many of us need to hear, and probably a lot more often than we recognize.
To do and to and
God, till I am wholly thine, until this earthly part of me flows with thy fire. Of God, so shall I never die, but live with thee the perfect life of thine
. Everyone sharing in this worship brings their own gifts to the community. Many of these gifts are unseen and may even be unrecognized by the givers. This is especially so when we gather online and for those who will be watching this after it has gone out live. Our calling as people of God is to feed those without access to other tables in the hope of easing the hunger of bodies, minds, and spirits. No matter where or when you are following this service, we pray to God to help us give our gifts with a ready mind, a willing spirit, and a joyful heart. Amen. And you will see listed on the slide a number of ways that you can participate by giving your offering.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures high and low. Give thanks to God in love made known. Creator, Word and Spirit.
They say when you sing, you pray twice. I think we have prayed well with that beautiful music. And now we pray with words. O holy Creator, in whom we live and have our being, we thank you for your presence among us and the presence of your Son, Jesus. We pray today for those for whom the question, who are you, is difficult to answer. Especially those who feel lost and forsaken, for those who are ill or abandoned, those who experience life as despised and downtrodden. We think today especially of all those whose identity limits their ability to live freely, especially those in Afghanistan. His future has become much more perilous in the last week, especially girls and women. We pray for all whose identity is a death sentence, and all who fear not so much the death of the body, but the death of hope. We pray for those who do not know who they are or whose they are. For those whose identity papers have been confiscated or destroyed. For those seeking a new identity in a new and safer place. For all searching deep within themselves to retrieve memory, a sense of self, a reason to believe, hope to sustain their living. And we pray for all who love and support them. Oh God, you have planted us in an ever-changing world. Help us to find the blessings of possibility in it. Let us be sustained by memories of stability, not so that we can hide from change or growth, but that we will be encouraged in the hope that what comes next will hold more blessings than our present anxieties. We pray for all those elected or re-elected to serve the people of Nova Scotia this past week. We pray that they will seek opportunities to work together for the sake of the people who call this place home. For the sake of those whose search for home has led them here. And for all who are without safe shelter to call home, even here in our own communities. In the presence of the bread of life, who refused food for himself in order to feed others first, we deepen our commitment to him who gave us these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Go forth for God, go to the world in peace. Be of good courage, armed with heavenly grace. In God's good spirit, daily to increase. Joy to serve. am, Lord, rejoicing in the Holy Spirit, come, go forth for God, go to the world in joy.
Before I give the blessing, I just want to let people know that next week we will be meeting in person to celebrate the sacrament of baptism. Please check the church website for more information regarding in-person worship as things begin to open up, and worship will continue to be offered online. So may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine on you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.
Don't sit in. Bye.